And good afternoon to all the Bandung's participants. First of all, I'd like to thank Francis for setting up Singapore site, having these remote presentations. And I thought today, instead of giving you an update in dengue epidemiology in Singapore, I will touch on managing dengue. Next slide. Do I control the system? It's not moving. Yeah, okay. So what I will do is in a very fast speed, go through current guidelines. And I think what is challenging to the clinician today is whether or not we have a very good reliable tool for us to have early diagnosis and be able to prognosticate these cases as early as possible, and how do we triage patient care? How do we further reduce the impact of the disease in the healthcare system, reducing the case fatality rate? So to many of you, I think you are very familiar with the 1997 WHO guideline showing you the spectrum of dengue infections can be from asymptomatic infections to symptomatic infections, from mild symptomatic cases to very severe cases, and some of the cases succumb to dengue infection as well. And in the 1997 classifications, we typically will classify patients into dengue fever, dengue hemorrhagic fever, and dengue shock syndrome using the standard guideline provided in the year 1997. And in a recent year, in 2011, CIRIO published another definitions, another guideline classifications. Now they include expanded dengue syndrome. So in other words, from complications that is due to plasma leakage, we now recognize that there are dengue cases that present with symptoms outside of what we have recognized in the past. And that takes up one spectrum of the disease manifestations under expected dengue syndrome. What is more important in the year 2009 guideline is in fact a description of the entire course of dengue. And it's broadly classified into three stages: the febrile stage, followed by critical period, and followed by the recovery period, or you know, in the clinical setting, we call it reabsorptions, where the fluid now returns back into the circulatory systems from the third space. So this, in fact, very nicely describes the entire clinical course, the temperature changes, as well as the blood parameter changes along the entire course of a dengue illness. And I think to the clinicians, this indeed is a very helpful guideline in terms of how we would monitor dengue cases in our day-to-day management. And in the year 2009, WHO also recommending this set of characterizing dengue cases into different sets of severity, which is very different from the year 1997. In this proposal, they recommended to have patients having probable dengue diagnosis, diagnosed as probable dengue, and a group of them with warning signs, and a group of them may progress to severe dengue infection, either due to severe plasma leakage, due to severe bleeding, or due to severe organ involvement. So you can see the current guideline available to us in the year 1997, as well as 2009, the content and some of potentially conflicting area that as a clinician we have to deal with. Now I'm going to take out from the WHO 2009 to look into the flow of clinical management. Essentially taken from the entire course of the descriptions of dengue infections as I presented to you earlier on. Many of the patients will present to their primary physicians in the primary healthcare, and indeed it can become a very challenging task to the primary physicians to be able to recognize these cases, to be able to suspect that these patients could have been infected with the dengue virus and make a diagnosis. And after the diagnosis is being made, it's important then for the clinicians to be able to recognize some of the cases may potentially progress to having more severe disease. And therefore, these cases should be best referred from primary care setting to the secondary care setting or to the hospital for hospitalizations. And within the hospital, it's important to set up the infrastructure to have a specialized care for dengue cases, where it's very specific and a specialized care can be given to the dengue patients. Overall, the entire scheme of things is we want to see our patients recover and we want to see no dengue mortality. So this is very common in any of the clinicians' office. Very common, we have patients coming to our clinic complaining of fever and very non-specific clinical illness, maybe very viral kind of looking viral etiology. But we have to ask ourselves, do we have adequate tool that is very easy to use, that is very affordable, quick, simple for us to make the diagnosis of dengue infection? And then it's important for us to also understand, to be able to utilize the right tool at the right place. So if you look at the dengue infections, at the point of infection, day number zero, the patients would have gone through intrinsic incubation period, that is roughly around about 7 days or so. At this point in time, the patients will experience fever, and also this point in time, they will also have viremia. And then followed by the recovery phase, where there's appearance of antibodies of different kind, IgM, IgG, and IgA. So we need to use the correct tool at the correct time to make the diagnosis. If my aim is to diagnose dengue early, which means that I will have to go for the detections of the virus, it's either have the isolations of virus or I go for a molecular tool to make a diagnosis of RNA. And today, I think NS1 detection has become familiar to many of us. So this will be the period, the critical period, if I need to make an early diagnosis, I in fact need to diagnose the presence of virus or virus antigen. By the time with the presence of antibodies, I think it is a late clinical diagnosis rather than an early clinical diagnosis. So for that point, we ask ourselves, the clinicians in Singapore, if I were to be a clinician in my clinic, do I have point of care tests? So in other words, in my clinic, without the interface of a laboratory support, can I make a diagnosis that is easy, quick, safe to use, that I can present the information or the results to the patients in my clinic? And this is what we did. We partnered with SD BioLine, and we did the study in a tertiary clinic setting where we have undifferentiated febrile patients recruited into this study, and we run the fingerprint NS1 test and compare it with a conventional test that is done in laboratory, a reference laboratory for the diagnosis of dengue. And using these combinations of NS1 and IgM, IgG, we were able to have a sensitivity of more than 90% by using this this kit. So in other words, it gives us the confidence that indeed in the doctor's office, we can introduce this concept of early diagnosis and early revealing of information to the patients. Now this is actually in fact nothing that novel, because it also has been done in other sites as well. This is a study done in Cambodia looking at one reference lab in a reference lab compared to two hospitals, one at a national level and one at a regional level. Looking at the lab itself, utilizing this test kit, the dual test kit, to compare whether or not there's any significant disparity between the reference lab compared to the servicing lab. So you can see from here, if you were to use NS1 test, in fact, the concordance rate is very high. So in other words, if the servicing lab, either in a hospital in the national hospital setting or in a regional hospital setting, the positive rate, if they read as positive, very likely the reference rate, where reference lab will also be reading a positive rate. However, you come to antibodies, somehow this performance lags behind. So all in all, you can see that if the hospitals were to utilize this testing modality, the sensitivity is close to 86% with a specificity of about 84% and a positive predictive value of close to 96%. So in other words, if the hospital were to use this as a test providing to the clinicians, it can give the clinicians a positive value of close to 96% and a negative predictive value of about 60%. However, in the reference lab, you can see that it performed much better. So then we have to ask ourselves, would this become available to the clinicians in that particular hospital to be able to utilize this testing ability? And then I'm pretty sure many of you are very familiar with these results, looking at the viremia level and then associate that to disease outcome. So from the available information currently, the higher the viral load, it tends to translate into a more disease severity outcome. So similarly, this is also being done using NS1. It shows very similar finding. The higher the NS1, the higher probability of patients progressing to a more severe illness. So these are a potential way of looking at how we can make an early diagnosis and further develop this technique to look at the different level to see the differentiate patients that likely that will progress to a severe disease. But we understand that this kind of laboratory test perhaps will take some time to come and perhaps you need validations. While WHO already given us some clinical indicators, this is what we call warning signs. So in other words, once you make a diagnosis of patients with dengue infections, look out for these warning signs that will point towards these patients likely will progress to more severe illness. And from here, you can see there are 7 warning signs that's proposed by WHO. I think most of the audience here are very familiar with this. So to do that, we look into our own study cohort in Singapore, asking these questions of the utility of warning signs in a prospective cohort over a period of 2 years in a research clinic in my hospital setting. So we include both inpatient and outpatient into this study, and we study mostly adult patients age 18 and above, and all the cases were confirmed by the dengue PCR test or using NS1 as a confirmations, and our research unit is managed by 3 well-trained medical officers. So, you know, they manage the patients in the clinic. So prospectively, we recruited hundreds of cases into this study, and we found that the mucosa bleeding is the most common warning signs. However, none of the warning signs give a clear predictions of disease progressions. But what is more important here, we found, is of its negative predictive value. So in other words, if our patients completely without any of the 7 warning signs, any one of the 7 warning signs, chances of this individual progress to severe disease is negligible. So then it begs these questions. Patients without a warning signs, we can safely manage at the primary care level without the need to refer them to the hospital for hospitalizations. But what would be the warning signs frequency in your community setting? It will be something that is very interesting to find out. In our study, looking at the utility of warning signs, we also found that from the onset of warning sign to the onset that defines severity, either dengue hemorrhagic fever or severe disease, in fact, pretty short. So in other words, it's only about a day in between the onset of warning sign and the onset of a dengue hemorrhagic fever. So in other words, in the clinical setting, we know warning signs, in fact, very common. None of the warning signs can predict disease progressions. However, not having warning signs is a very good negative prediction that patients likely will not progress. And having a warning sign to severe disease outcome, in fact, is a very short period. So then we have to ask ourselves, how are we going to utilize warning signs to guide our own management setting in our admission criteria? I think this will be something that is very important for the clinicians to relook into that and design the clinical management workflow. As in Singapore, when we look at our retrospective dengue mortality over 5 years period and across all the public hospital, we found that in our dengue situations in Singapore, dengue infect mostly adult, and we have older adults with dengue infections, and the mortality, the death cases were contributed mostly by those aged 45 and above. And we look at the warning signs in that particular cohort, almost all of them had at least one warning sign. So that is something that, you know, perhaps we can learn and further sharpen the use of warning signs, plus many of the laboratory tests that we can use to further sharpen the disease management. So in Singapore, the dengue case fatalities dropped significantly. So despite large number last year and continue to have large number of dengue cases in Singapore this year, we don't have high mortality rate as compared to the previous year. So we thought that this could be because that this increased awareness among the clinicians in the community, and we are able to provide better diagnostic capability and helping the clinicians to diagnose these cases, identify these cases as early as possible so as to be able to provide them the necessary supporting care. And whether or not this is a virus, a strain change and things like that will be something that, you know, that will require further studies to substantiate some of these points. So I think we promised only 15 minutes and, yes. And that was my last slide. I think lastly, I'd like to thank all my collaborators in making many of this study and many of these results make possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Prof. Leo.